You deserve a good. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the privilege given unto your children, Lord, to be called your children today and to be here with us, Father. Yes. We thank you for those who are not here also. Yes. We thank you for those who do not have understanding of your word and your ways yet, Father. We thank you for those who have given understanding of your ways and your word and your kingdom too. We thank you, Father, today. We appreciate you, Lord. We have not taken anything for granted, Lord. You are a faithful God. You are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. You are the Ancient of Days. We appreciate you. We glorify you. We honor you and we lift up your name, Father. King of Kings, we thank you. Father, we want to go into your presence today to hear from you, Lord. We want to hear the word of deliverance, the word of healing, the word of safety, the word of liberation, and the word of your kingdom, the knowledge of your kingdom, Father. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, Lord.
Amen.
Let your word come unto us, Lord, for transformation, amen, for redemption, for to repair, to reprove, and to correct us today, Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And give us the spirit of obedience, Father. Give us the spirit of humility to obey, Father, and to follow you wholeheartedly, Father. We thank you because you are the Lord and Savior. Bless every of the souls that will listen to this, oh Lord, on the radio, online, wherever they will be, Lord. And let the same impartation of your spirit released in this auditorium, Lord,
amen,
be given unto them, Father, as they're listening online, on radio, wherever they will listen to it. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, Lord.
Amen.
Shake them from the foundation of their head,
yes,
to the
Lord,
foot, Father. And let every hindrance, every satanic bondage tying your life to a spot spiritually be broken, Lord, as you listen to this word. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth,
amen,
I command that every veil that the enemy is using to cover your veil to the, your faces and your mind and your spirit against the gospel be broken, be torn down, be removed. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, Lord,
amen,
I decree that the Lord will release the spirit to set you free today. In the name of Jesus, so shall it be.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name, I decree and pray.
Amen.
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 Amen. Let me hear the resounding amen from your voice.
Amen.
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 In Jesus' name. Let somebody clap for Jesus as you're sitting down. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Be seated. Be seated. Be seated. Amen. Be seated. And I want you to show me your Bible. Say, this is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
I can't see everybody saying that. No excuse. This is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
Grab your Bible and say, this is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
Shake it. Shake it. Say, this is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
Shake it as if it belonged to you. You didn't borrow it. Shake like this. This is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
It belongs to me. I did not borrow it.
It belongs to me. I did not borrow
it's
it.
It's not a loan from anybody.
It's not a loan from anybody.
I can do what it says I can do.
I can do what it says I can do.
I can have what it says I can have.
I can have what it says I can have.
I boldly confess it as I mean it.
In Jesus' mighty name.
If it's as clean as my own, if you have not removed it from the corner of your room, kiss it and say, I love my Bible. Amen. 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 Because some people will clean their Bible before they kiss it. Because it's been long. They saw it last Sunday. But if you have been seeing your Bible every day, you can kiss it. It's clean. Amen.
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 Wow. It's another wonderful day to hear from the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
I'm excited. I'm happy. And at the same time, my heart is broken. My heart is what? Broken. I don't want anybody speaking at this time. It is serious today. Very serious. All I need to do is to listen with your ears, not with mouth. Listen with your ears. I want everybody to listen. It's very serious. Because it's one of the messages from the Lord. First of all, before I speak from the Bible, I want to speak from the Revelation. You see, on Friday after the night vigil here, for the people that came to the night vigil, after the night vigil, we went to sleep in the morning, and that sleep on the Saturday morning before I woke up, this is where the revelation came from. And I believe the Lord wants me to say this to all people. To say this to all people. Because this is the end time. The end time is near, and the devil is having upper hand in every church among every believer. That is why I want you to listen. I don't want you to speak. In that revelation, I saw a very large congregation of church people. When I mean church, I mean people. It looked like there was festival or program or crusade. Not a crusade, but a church conference. Many churches, and it was an interdenominational program. Everybody came. I saw some Hartley musicians that you know. I don't want to mention names. They were also in the program. I saw some pastors, I saw some believers, I saw even drama, some drama ministers. Everybody was just there. It was a big program. And as we were seated, And it was like the sitting of hypocrite. It was like a sitting of hypocrite. And like a gathering of adulterer and adulteress. And there was a spirit that was speaking to me at this stage as we were sitting down there. Before the spirit spoke, the people that were sitting there, there was a man and woman that was they were talking. And as they were talking, they were supposed to be believers. Listen to this. They were Christian, but they were talking to praise the devil. They were talking to magnetize the devil. Let me tell you some of the things they were saying. Say, devil is very powerful. You need to be careful. The witches are very powerful. They can do this, they can do that. They were just saying many things that the devil and the witches can do. So I now intervene at that stage. I say, why are you speaking like this? In this kind of program, why don't you tell us what God can do? Why don't you tell us the power in the blood of Jesus? Why don't you tell us the supremacy and dominion that the Lord has given us over the power of darkness and all the wiles of the devil? Why do you talk more about what the devil can do, what he can do to people, how he can destroy people, how he can poison people, how he can drug people in the dream and feed people in the dream and so on and so forth? And the people got angry with me, especially the man that was speaking. He said, what do you mean by that? Can't you see for yourself? Can't you see in the world that we live in? Can't you see how the devil is taking dominion? How is he terrorizing people? How some people are getting pressed up in the dream? How many? Who are you to? You don't see that? I said, it's not that I don't see it. I was still telling to the people. It's not that I don't see it. But I am saying that God is more powerful. We are supposed to be Christians. In this kind of program and convention, interdenominational, we should gather to revive the trust and belief in the power of God and the blood of Jesus. That's what I'm saying. I'm not saying that they don't exist. And the man just stood up and the woman, they were hungry. They want to leave my side. And they didn't want to listen. They changed the topic. They didn't want to leave. They said, if they don't understand, if I don't want to understand what they're saying, they don't want to understand what I'm saying. I still insisted and I followed. I said, we are supposed to be Christian, aren't we? Are we not supposed to glorify God that we serve? They just left. I said, okay, if you don't want me, I want to listen to you. I want you to teach me how you think devil has power more than the church of God. Come and tell me. Maybe I don't understand you. Come and tell me your own point. So when they saw that I talked like that, they wanted to come back to tell me. So immediately, the Spirit took my mind from that scene and it took my mind to another place that he wanted me to know. It was like just like I was shown that picture and he wanted me to know something. I don't know how to explain this to you because that's what happens to me sometimes. So, and he was explaining to me that that is what the church has become. Every big name believers, every strong people said, let me show you another one. Then he showed me another one. He was like some people, they wear white garments. Just, and they were dancing rigorously. They are supposed to be believers. They are running. They put something like a platform and an altar, and they were dancing around it. When I saw that, I thought they were angels first of all because they wear white garments and they were shouting. They were dancing around the platform and the altar. They were dancing, and the spirit came on the spirit to say, "You see, that is another group. Very, very rigorous, very tough, very dedicated." But they are just religious. Every of these acts you see them doing like angels, they are religious. It does not get beyond that place where they are praying. And some of them even worship angels, thinking that they are worshiping God. They glorify angels. They worship angels. They do not worship God. And they are just, their faith is no longer unto me, but they are just, their faith is in religion. Some of them don't even know why they inherited that. They were born into that. Because it's an inheritance. You know, Christianity has become inheritance. We inherit it and we continue from where our father stopped. Our father used to wear white garments. They used to clap. They used to dance around this. That's what we do also. They don't understand why their father did that. They don't have connection to heaven. So what the Lord wants me to tell you today is these two things. My time does not permit me to tell you all the revelation. But the message is very important. And the message is, the whole world has become adulterer and adulteress followers. Adulterer and adulteress followers. And they are in group. They go to church. Some of them are ministers. They preach. Some of them are not ministers. They are followers. They are dedicated. Some of them, they are chronic believers. They don't wear ring, the earring. They don't wear trousers. They wear skirt. They dress nicely. They wear scarf. But yet, they are as religious as their fathers. There is no difference between the religion of their father and themselves. Because their salvation is not connected to God, to trusting God. The more religious they are, the more they have uniform of a Christian, but their heart does not have faith in God. They fear devil more. They glorify devil more. They magnify witches more. Yet, they tie scarf around the ears. Yet, they wear nice skirts down and flowing. Yet, they don't wear earrings and neck chain. Yet, they don't wear any makeup. Yet, they glorify and magnify the devil. They are afraid of each other. They are afraid of one another. There is no unity in their midst. They do not agree on one thing. In that interdenominational gathering that I saw in the Revelation, we did not agree among ourselves. We have different opinions. We have different thoughts. We have different beliefs. Yet, we are joined together in the flesh, in uniform, physically. But our heart is divided. Our faith is segregated. Our belief is separated. It does not look alike. I want you to give me your ears today and your heart. I want everybody to look unto me. If I'm not saying you should write anything, just look to me. Look at me and listen. Because as you are here, I want to share this with your brothers, your sisters, your aunt, your auntie, your nephew and your nieces, and your mommy and daddies, if you are young people. Your friends, your colleagues at work, at school. That the whole world is hypocritical. The whole church is adulterous on heart. Every church on heart, I'm not fearing one of them. Every church on heart that you can name, it can be redeemed, it can be mountain of fire, it can be a church of God, it can be a potter's house, it can be whatever in America, in Asia, in Africa, every part of the world, the Lord has revealed that his church is adulterous church. It's not even his church, it's our church that we created. It's not the church of God. We are not running church of God on earth. We are running adulterous church. Harlot's church. Church of adultery on earth. And from there, like I told you, I do not have time. I am not organizing a prophecy recording. I am preaching today. And therefore, I cannot say more than that. I go straight to the message. In our Bible reading, it's a long Bible passage, and I just want somebody that will not say, oh, maybe I'll read it myself, because this is serious. Exodus chapter 32, everybody, from verses 1 to 35. Exodus 32, 1 to 35. It's a very long one, that's why I say I will read it myself. In the book of Exodus, Genesis, Exodus, okay.
Exodus 13.
32. 32. Open Bible with your hand, not with mouth. Open Bible with hand. Please. Open. It's very serious today. No joke today. Open Bible with hand, not with mouth. Exodus 32. My heart has been very disturbed. And I've been very... I wish I could be speaking in front of 10,000 people this morning. But I believe he that lives in you is more than 10,000 people. Amen?
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 Hallelujah. From verse 1. Now, when the people... Are we all there? If you are there, wave your hand. Amen? Now, let's go. Follow it with your eyes as I read. Verse 1. Exodus 32. Exodus 32. From verse 1. Now, when the people saw that Moses delayed coming down from the mountain, the people gathered together to Aaron and said to him, come, make us gods that we go before us. For as for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him. I stop there. We are going to 32, 35. Now look at the people that God brought from Egypt. Through a servant that it was called Moses. A feasible servant, human being, a prophet God sent to deliver the people. And they got to the wilderness. The prophet went to seek the face of God. And he spent 40. He didn't know how long it would take him. He would have told him that he would spend 40 days. He went there and the waiting on the Lord was going to 40 days. And by the time he was there, the people were surrounded. Only 40 days, they said, this man that brought us to this wilderness, we cannot see him. Sit down. I want everybody to sit right. I don't want anybody bending head on the Bible. Sit right as if you are taking picture. And look at me, please. I beg you. I can command you when you are in here. When we finish service, you have authority. But when I'm speaking, I have authority, isn't it?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Anybody speaking has authority to speak. And when I finish my speaking, you can. If I say come, you might not come. I give you that one. But now I am your master here. Amen?
Amen.
Uh-huh. Because I'm the speaker. You gave me authority to speak to you, isn't it?
Yes.
Uh-huh. So let's cooperate and let's go. Now look at the person. It was human being that God sent to save them, isn't it? And they are not saying, Aaron. That Aaron was supposed to be a priest. An apostle of the Lord and a prophet was sent to deliver his people. And the apostle of the Lord went with Joshua. And what happened? What happened? Before they returned, the priest, the pastor, amen? The pastor that was left with them. Now, the evangelists and the prophet, they have delivered them. They gone, they delivered them from Egypt. They brought them into a place in God's presence. And the prophet went to seek the face of God. And he left them in charge of the pastor, a priest. Okay? And these people went to the priest, the pastor, say, Pastor, Jesus that is coming, we cannot see him more. We don't see Jesus that you people say he's coming for a long time. That is what they are saying here. We have not seen Moses that brought us out of Egypt. He has gone. We don't know what has become of him. So make us another God. Can you make somebody that will lead you when God used human being to lead you? Now look at what I'm saying. Human being went to bring them. They now want something, a thing that is molded with hand to lead them through the rest of the journey. Do you see how foolish human being can be? Do you understand what I'm saying? God sent human beings to bring them out with miracles. They now want to make idol to continue the rest of the journey. Because of what? Because they were delivered from Egypt, but they were not delivered from their father's idol. They were only delivered from Egypt, but they were not delivered from their father's idol. Their father's idol is in their mind, but their only body was delivered from Egypt. There are many people that are listening to me today, or that will listen to me. They have been saved in the church, but they have not been delivered from the sins of their father in their soul, in their blood. That is why when they now get to the church, a place of unity, a place of God, a place of learning about heaven, they become idolatrous and idolaters. Because they brought that into the church through the vein of their father that's living in them. And you get to know what I'm saying today. Now I continue reading. And Aaron said to them, break off the golden earrings which are in your ears, in the ears of your wives, your sons and your daughters, and bring them to me. So all the people broke off the golden earrings which were in their ears and brought them to Aaron. And he received the gold from their hand, and he fashioned it with an engraving tool and made a golden calf. You know what a calf is? Like a cow. They made a cow with gold. And look at what they said to the cow after they had made it. Then they said, this is your God. Can you imagine that? They made a cow with gold earrings. They collect, you know, there were plenty. Several thousands of people. So they have plenty gold. And they melted it. They use carving instruments and they carve it, they boil it with hot fire and they mold a cow and they put it on the platform and they call the whole people, here is the God that will lead you through the rest of the journey. I want you to listen to that and hold it in your hands as I read on. Now, the next verse. He said, then they said, this is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt. So when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it, and Aaron made a proclamation and said, tomorrow is a feast to the Lord. Then they rose early on the next day, offered burnt offering, and brought peace offering, and people sat down to eat and drink, and rose up to the play. And the Lord said to Moses, Go get down, for your people whom you brought out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves. Then the Lord told Moses there where he was praying, he said, go down quickly to your people. They have started corruption. The sins of their father is already pursuing them. They have built a calf and they call the calf God. Go back and meet them. Stop your prayer. And the Moses quickly make arrangements, because Joshua was waiting for him halfway, so he quickly went back to Joshua and said, God said there is something happening. And look at what happened next. They have made themselves a molten calf and worship it and sacrifice to it and said, this is our God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt. Was it a calf that brought them out of Egypt? That is what they claim. They said, that is what brought us out of Egypt. And let it begin to lead us. Something that cannot work. No wonder the Bible says, how terrible is the trouble of those who worship idols. He said, most of them, they are just like the calf that the idol they worship. They have mouth, they cannot speak. Ears, they cannot hear. They have eyes, they cannot see. And word cannot be uttered from their throat. And those who worship them are just like what? They are like them. If they were not like them, how can you call human being to lead you? When they cannot walk, you call a calf to lead you. Something that cannot walk, that you have to carry to go. And look at what happened. Verse 9. And the Lord said to Moses, I have seen these people, and indeed it is a stiff-necked people. Now therefore, let me alone, that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them, and I will make of you a great nation. Then Moses pleaded with the Lord and said, God, Lord, why does your wrath have burn hot against your people, whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians speak and say, he brought them out to harm them, to kill them in the mountain and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce wrath and relent from this harm to your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servant, to whom you swore by your own self and said to them, I will multiply your descendants as the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have spoken, and I give to you, to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever. So the Lord relented from the harm which he said he would do to his people. 15. And Moses turned and went down from the mountain, and two tablets of the testimony were in his hand. The tablets were written on both sides, on the side and on the other side. They were written. Now the tablets were the work of God, and the writing was the writing of God engraved on the tablet. And when Joshua heard the noise of the people that they shouted, he said to Moses, there is a noise of war in the camp. But he said, that is Moses, it is not the noise of the shout of the victory, nor the voice of the cry of the defeat, but the shout, the sound of singing I hear. 19. So it was, as soon as he came near the camp, that he saw the calf and the dancing. So Moses' anger became hot, and he cast the tablets out of his hands and broke them at the foot of the mountain. Then he took the calf which they had made burned it in the fire and the ground and grinded it to powder, and he scattered it on the water and made the children of Israel drink it. And Moses said to Aaron, what is this? What did these people made you do that you have brought so great a sin upon them? And so Aaron said, look at what Aaron said. And so Aaron said, do not let the anger of my Lord become hot. You know the people, that they are set on evil. For they said to me, make us gods that shall go before us. And for this Moses, the man who brought us out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him. And I said to them, whoever has any gold, let them bring it up. So they gave it to me, and I cast it into the fire, and this calf came out. Now when Moses saw that the people were unrestrained, for Aaron had not restrained them, so their shame among their enemies. Then Moses stood in the entrance of the camp and said, whoever is on the Lord's side, come to me. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves together to him. And he said to them, thus says the Lord God of Israel, let every man put this his sword on his side and go in and out from the entrance to the entrance throughout the camp. And let every man kill his brother, every man his companion, and every man his neighbor. So the sons of Levi did according to the word of Moses, and about 3,000 men of the people fell dead that day. Then Moses said, consecrate yourself today to the Lord, and he may bestow on you a blessing this day. For every man has opposed his son and his brother. Now it came to pass. Amen.
Amen.
Now, before I continue to read the rest of the story, I want you to be very careful of what Aaron said. When Moses asked Aaron, why did you do this? Why did you have to leave? You are supposed to be a priest. Why did you join these people? Even though the people are ignorant, you are supposed to know more. Mm-hmm. He said, I'm sorry, these people are over 6,000 people. They pressurized me. They wanted something. I have to give them what they want. And I have to dance along with them. That is what is happening to all the churches now. Because the Lord Jesus has delay in coming. Because the Lord Jesus has delay in coming, they have forgotten that death is inevitable. Even Jesus does not show up in rapture, you are expecting that they would die. They forgot that they would die. They were only expecting God in Moses. Because as far as they are concerned, Moses was their God. Just like in that revelation, the message there was that people have made ministers of the gospel their God. They do not see the main God, the real God that created them. They obey the ministers of the gospel more than God. That was part of the message in the revelation that I was telling you about. People made ministers of the gospel their God instead of God. So therefore, when the minister of the gospel make one mistake, they are already gone out of the church. Because they gave their life to that pastor, not God. If there is anything that befell a pastor, they are gone. And if the pastor also tell them to do anything, they do it. But if the Lord tell them to do that thing, they will not do it. If somebody among us now go on the radio, he say, God has told me that the whole world should fast on so day, on Christmas Day. They will just smile and just off their radio. But when a giant minister that they know say that, believe me, they will do what? They will do just that. They will obey that. They will say, this man has done many miracles. People don't believe in God. They believe in human being that God has sent. And because the human being that God has sent see that they don't believe in God, so therefore, he wants to keep them in the church. Most Aaron wanted to keep the people. He didn't want them to go back to Egypt. And they now told Aaron, this is what the kind of gospel we want. That's what we do now. We tell pastor that kind of message you want to hear. Do you know people do that now? They go to churches where we preach the message they want to hear. They do what? They go to the churches that preach the message they want to hear. And if you are preaching that the kind of message that makes them fear, remember their sin, they will not come. They will not come to you. They will not sit there with you. That was what happened. What happened? What is happening now has already happened before. But it happened in another way. Jesus Christ is tarries before he coming, and people already changing the gospel. Ministers of God and God has left in charge of the people, like Aaron was in charge of the Egyptians. They already changing the message because they discovered that the people want good messages. They know that people want they want to preach what people like to listen to. They don't want to preach what God wants them to listen to. They don't want people to see God that has sent them to preach to the people. They now begin to change the message because people like to hear those messages. I want to call upon them today. If any man of God will listen to this message online, of course, I have men of God here that are young too, growing. And those who listen, I beg you in the name of God, this is a call to wake up from our slumber. The Lord wants you to preach his message to his people, not your message or what the people ask you to do. If you discover people only gather to your church because they like what you tell them, you must change today and tell them what God wants you to tell them. Aaron wanted the people to do, he wanted to love the people. He wanted the people to be around him. Therefore, when the people came to him, Aaron, we want another God. And Aaron said, okay, give me your earrings. And he made them another God. He said, this is your God. He made animal their God. He made your animal and they celebrated the dance. And Aaron too cooperated well with them. He said, tomorrow we are going to do festival around this, our God, our new God. A priest, Aaron, the whole Aaron that was ordained by God. He cooperated with the people to celebrate idol. Aaron cooperated with people to celebrate idol because he wanted the people around him. He wanted to maintain his position as a priest. He also thought Moses had gone, maybe Moses is dead in the wilderness. He believed Moses is dead also. So, if Moses did not come back, that is the way Calf would have been the God of Israel up to today. That was why God said, Moses, go back quickly. Something is happening. There is an emergency. Your people, you left only 40 days, they are already choosing another God. They find another God in animal. Foolishness. They believe in animal is their God and their deliverer. I continue to read. Let me finish you quickly because we are going a little long way. Verse 19. So it was, as soon as he became near the camp, that he saw the calf and the dancing. Oh no, sorry. Verse 30 now. Now it came to pass on the next day that Moses said to the people, you have committed a great sin. So now I will go up to the Lord. Perhaps I can make atonement for your sin. Then Moses returned to the Lord and said, oh, these people have committed a great sin and have made for themselves a god of gold. Yet now, if you will forgive their sin, but if not, I pray, blot me out of your book which you have written. Look at Moses. He wanted to make himself a sacrifice. If you don't want to forgive them, then you blot my name out of your way, out of your book. And God said, no, I don't blot the name of innocent people out of my book. Look at what he said. 33. And the Lord said to Moses, whoever has sinned against me, I will blot his name out of my book. Not you. You have not sinned. Anyone that sinned is what I remove from my book. Because there is one book that is called Book of Life. Any sinner, when we came to this world, we were all in his book. Everybody, when you were a baby, God put you, Cecilia, Jewel, in his book of those people that are coming to heaven. Abraham, Jewel, when you were born. So name. Many names. So, but when you grow to choose a God for yourself, in ignorance, say, this is my God, this is the way I want to live. This is the way I want to live my life. And you go out of his plan. Then he removes with eraser, he removes your name from people that are coming to heaven. Then you now become vulnerable until you find somebody that will speak to you the word of God. To repent and go back to God. Because repentance is what you need. Let us read. We will come back to that. So God made it clear. He said, Moses, you are not the one that sinned. You cannot pay. It is not done like that in heaven. In heaven, you don't pay for anybody's sin. No human being is entitled to pay for another person's sin. You have not sinned, your name cannot be removed. Anyone that has sinned against me is what I will remove their name from my book. Not you, Moses. 34. Now therefore, go lead the people to the place of which I have spoken to you. Behold, my angel shall go before you. Nevertheless, in the day when I visit for punishment, I will visit punishment upon them for their sin. So the Lord plagued the people because of what they did with the calf, which Aaron had made. Amen. You see, now this is the image of what we do now. The old church in this world, they have now what we call golden image. We have chosen God for ourselves in all the churches. Because in that revelation, it was a combination of all churches that the Lord was letting me to understand that the church have made for themselves image that they serve, not God. The church has made for themselves image, and they have become idolaters and harlots. They play harlotry with God. And we go on quickly in the message. Our memory verse is found in the book of James, chapter 4, verse 4. James 4, verse 4. James 4, verse 4. It says, adulterer and adulteress, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Adulterer, adulteress. Men and women of the church. Men and women in the church. You must know today, that's what he's saying. Everyone, every young and old in the church, you must know that the friendship with the world is enmity with God. And let me tell you the image that the church has made. Can I tell you the image of the church?
Yes.
The church has not made calf. They have not made goat. They have not made an image of animal in the church today, but they have made the image of what? Worldliness in the church. Every church of God on earth today, they have made another image, they remove God from the church. And the image they made is worldliness. The image the world has made today is called worldliness. And they have introduced worldliness to every member of the church. This is your God. This is your Savior. If you can behave like this, you go to heaven. Don't mind those people that are picking rubbish. Worldliness is another image, and everybody is celebrating worldliness. The ministers of the gospel, they have declared to people to dance before worldliness, to celebrate worldliness, to enjoy worldliness, to dwell in worldliness, and they praise God with worldliness. And they have made themselves adulterer and adulteresses by behaving in the such way. We move on quickly. I wrote there, I said, harlotry of God's people. The harlotry of God's people is described. I want us to see description of the way people make harlotry. The people of God, the way they do harlotry in the church. In the book of Hosea, Hosea chapter 4. Hosea chapter 4, it's after Daniel. Hosea chapter 4, verses 6 to 13. If you get to Daniel, you turn right. Hosea 4. Hosea 4, 6 to 13.
Hosea 4, 6, he says, my people, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge.
Look at that. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge.
Because you have rejected knowledge,
mm-hmm.
I also will reject you from being priests for me.
You see that? It's not that they do not see the knowledge, but they deliberately rejected knowledge. That is what the church has become today. When I was speaking on Saturday, I said, when Jesus came, where do you think he preached first? He preached in the churches that he met on earth. So now, which means the church on earth now, they have problems. Our preaching must be to the church of the heart now. And I want all churches to listen to me. All people here to listen today. You are nations as you are sitting down here. And the word you speak to other people as you live here, you share with them also, can make an impact in their lives. I have told you that the whole church of the world, they have made themselves image. Just like the children of Israel made image of calf. But what did I call the image that the church has made today?
Worldliness
is the name of the image that the church have made in all churches. Every church in Jamaica, every church in America, every church in Asia, every church in Africa, every church in Europe, they have this image on their platform, on their altar. How do I say that? All you need to do is to turn your TV on. And you look at their pulpit, physical pulpit. I'm not talking about a spiritual altar now. The worldliness starts from their pulpit. You will see whether he comply with the word, the platform that Marie Garcia used to sing.
Yes.
You will see whether he look alike or not. Does he look alike with the church one or not?
Yes.
That is where you begin to know. That is the one lineage. That's where he started from. The church of God was not like that before. Children, you might be young now. Huh? Some of us are young people here. You started, some of us were, majority of my listeners here, that just a little bit, maybe some of you are born 99, 2000. And above, apart from our mommies, you see? So, majority of them, my voice, do not know the way church used to look at like before. The church was not like this before, young people. It is the image that the church has built in the church that has made turned the church to be like this. We have become adulterer and adulteress, serving the name of the Lord, serving the Lord and serving the word. And the book of James says, friendship with the world is what? Enmity. You cannot love God and also love world at the same time. It is not possible. You cannot do what? You cannot. No slave can serve what? Two masters. You either love one and hate the other. So if you love the world, you can never love God. If you love God, you can never love the world. So forget about what people say, my salvation is in my heart. It stays here in my heart. It's a lie. Once every of your character does not show that you love the Lord, then in your heart also you don't love the Lord. Do you understand that?
Yes.
Then you can, in this one, you cannot hide your salvation. It is visible. Whatever you believe in your heart will affect your character and attitude. When your attitude and your character does not show somebody that loves God, because the Bible said in our Bible study yesterday, in our the general Bible study yesterday, we told us that the steps to loving God, the meaning of loving God.
Yeah.
The people that were there yesterday, what is the first step of loving God?
Love your neighbor.
Love your neighbor.
Because the Lord says, if you don't love your neighbors, how do you that you can see? How do you love me that you cannot see? And how do you love your neighbor? 1 Corinthians 13 tells us, when you endure all things, you bear all things, you are not puffed up, you are not, you don't oppress your neighbor, you are not hurting them, you are not lying to them, you are not cheating them. That is how to love your neighbors. Then when you are doing this to people, you endure them, you don't fight, you don't anger, you are not easily provoked, then you are showing that you love God. And after you have loved God, what happened? You love your neighbor, you love God, then the next step, after loving God, you now see yourself obeying his commandment. And when you obey his commandment, then you now become holy. That's the way it works. So don't let anybody deceive you to say nobody can be holy. Because the Bible says if you are not holy, you cannot see God. That's why he says clearly in that book of Hebrew that you must pursue what? Peace. And what? Holiness, without which no one can see the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
So, Hosea, continue.
Because you have forgotten the law of your God, I also will forget your children.
You see that? I want everybody to wake up, every parent that will hear this word, or parent-to-be, wake up. Because this 2017 is a year of punishment for those Christians that refuse to repent. Because their children will be forgotten. Their children will cause them pain. They will be sorrowful. They will pursue God, they will not hear his voice. They will pray, their prayer will not be answered. Because the Lord has waited for long for them to repent. Because the Lord has sent knowledge to them, they reject knowledge. They say they don't want knowledge. It's not that knowledge is not given to the church. God sent some minor people He showed them revelation and vision. Go and tell the church to repent. Go and tell the people to come back to me. They mock such people. They ridicule such people. They say, who are you to speak to us? When did you, somebody that got born again in my presence here, when did you start ministry and you come and tell me what to do in my ministry? Who is your mentor? How were you mentored to become a preacher? And you come and tell me. It does not matter who mentor who. It does not matter when you were called. It does not matter how you were called. What matter is you must be born again. Do you know who is older between Aaron and Moses?
Moses.
They don't come again. It's okay. Just leave her. Make it and leave her. If you don't know me, I know. Amen.
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 Aaron was his brother. Moses is the younger. But Moses was the one that God was sending to repair all things, to fix all things. Even when Moses came back, he told Aaron, "Say, why did you allow this to happen? My big brother, why did you allow this to happen? The Lord just told me that this is happening." But if any Moses go to any Aaron nowadays, if any Moses go to any Aaron nowadays, they will tell you the day you were born. That, don't you know, Moses, I was there, I was baby feeding you when they took you to Pharaoh's house. In my presence here, the Pharaoh's daughter carried you to go to palace. My mother born you long time before you were born. I started seeing vision and revelation before you were called. Where were you when I was a priest, small priest in Israel? Where you did? And you now come to say God called you inside wilderness when you run away after killing somebody. Criminal. You know what I'm saying? You be criminal and they look for you. Pharaoh, they look for you if you don't know. They will not be using that one to terrorize Moses. Pharaoh is looking for you. The new Pharaoh knows about your case. You might think the whole Pharaoh is dead. You now come back, After the first Pharaoh died. The new Pharaoh knows about your case. Your case is there for table. You kill somebody, you run away for wilderness. And you now come back and say you be prophet. You now say, God say. What did God say? We will take your fight to Pharaoh. You will open your case. Criminal. That is what the Pharaoh of nowadays will do. The Aaron of nowadays. But the Aaron of those days, he was humble enough to say, I'm sorry. These people wanted to choke me. They wanted another God. That is why I had to make them another God. Even though his decision was wrong, but he was humble to repent from his sin. And they destroyed the calf and they poured the powder away onto the waters. But the Pharaoh, the Aaron of nowadays, please, every Aaron nowadays in churches, every priest of our days, every pastor of nowadays, repent and be humble. Let the idol of the church be broken.
Amen.
Let the idol of the church be broken.
Amen.
Let the worldliness be broken out of the church.
Amen.
Let immorality be broken out of the church.
Amen.
You must receive knowledge. The Bible says, because you do not receive knowledge, I also reject you as a priest in my church. Many priests is going to be rejected openly next year, 2017. The Lord will disgrace some of them openly if they refuse to repent and destroy worldliness out of the church. That image on the altar of the ugly churches, that is worldly. It needs to be pulled down.
Amen.
Yes, continue.
The more they increase, the more they sin against me.
The more they increase, the more sinner they become.
I will change their glory into shame.
Uh-huh.
They eat up the sin of my people.
Uh-huh.
They set their heart on their iniquity.
Uh-huh.
And it shall be like people like Greece. I will punish them for their ways.
You see that?
And reward them for their deeds.
You see, he said it shall be like people, like priests. You know when they say like father, like son, like mother, like daughter. Now this generation is like people, like priests. Is that true or not?
Yes.
When you see some people now, they are not different from their pastors. Brother, when you see some people in some churches, are they different from their pastor or not? They are the same. Like people, like priests. Like people, like priests. Like people, like priests. When you see them, The way they are worldly, when you see that, you know, when you see those churches, you will see worldliness. Even that worldliness image in their church will appear on the members.
Yes.
And when you see their members, go and check their pastor, they are the same. It's not different.
Yes.
This is what the Lord is talking about. Yes?
For they shall eat, but not have enough.
They will eat, but will never have enough.
They shall commit adultery, but not increase, because they have ceased obeying the law.
Mm-hmm.
11. Adultery, wine, and new wine enslave the heart.
Mm-hmm.
12. My people ask a counsel from their wounded idols.
They ask for counsel from wounded idols.
And their staff informs them.
Uh-huh.
For the spirit of idolatry has caused them to stray. And they have played the idols against their gods.
Last verse.
13. They offer sacrifice on the mountains.
On the mountaintops.
And burn incense on the hills. Under ox, poplars, and terebin. Because their shade is good. Therefore, your daughters commit adultery. And your brides commit adultery.
Amen. Your daughters commit adultery, and your brides commit adultery. That is the way the church do their adultery and halotry in the church nowadays. Every member of the church. Because the Lord has delayed in his coming, the church has become something else. In the 60s, in the 50s, in the early 70s, this is not the gospel that was going in the churches. Because people were thinking Jesus would come at that time. If when you heard gospel, you think, in fact, when I got saved, I thought Jesus would come in 1990-something. I got saved in the 80-something. So my belief was that around a few years after that, Jesus would come. Just like every other believer at that time, they thought the same way. But when Jesus now delayed to come, they now say, they didn't know, but it happened spiritually to them. Then this Jesus is not coming. Then we have to make another image for ourselves. We have to make another image for ourselves. Otherwise, we will not go to church again. If our pastor don't listen to us, we will not go to church again. And when the pastor also looks at people, they are not getting crowd, what do? They build the image for the people. They build what? They build the image of the people. I am not afraid to speak this today because I believe this message is being recorded and will go online to places. I will mention name of churches because the time is gone when we need to be quiet and timid. Every church has built image. The redeemed Christian of church has built image in the church. And the purpose of the building their image is to increase their membership. And how did they do it? It happened the day that the leader, that the new pastor, the new leader, General Overseer, decided to say, I want to blend between civilization and the kind of message my father in the Lord gave me. Because the father in the Lord of Redeemed Christian Church is a decent, no-nonsense man. And therefore, a man came through the glory of God and became another General Overseer. And he wanted to blend between the civilized and those of that time. Therefore, the gospel was a little bit leveraged. It became leveraged and they blended. The same thing happened to all those churches that have become big. Many churches in America too. The Porter's House, Billy Graham, and so on and so forth. Everybody decided to build a calf. And that calf they built in their own ministry is worldliness. It is not about Africa alone. Go to American churches in the 70s. You see their dressing. You see their look. But compare it with nowadays. Every church has built the image of worldliness to leverage between civilization and the good gospel. Because they want people to come. They want people to come as they are. And when they come, it's not a bad thing for people to come to church the way they are. But they must come to change, isn't it?
Yes.
Not to come and pollute the church. People must come the way they are. And when they come, they do what? They change, they repent. The mountain of fire miracle ministry are the same thing. The Lord called the minister wholeheartedly. And he sent him. But when he got to a place, the same stage, everybody used to build that calf. A stage that ministry used to do that is the stage when they want to become popular and big. The Lord give them the grace with anointing. But as soon as they have passion to begin to expand all over the world, then they build that image show up again in the mountain of fire. it becomes the image of worldliness. Now, the worldliness of mantle of fire is not dressing. It's the worldliness of believing that everything they want to do has to be deliverance. And glorifying the name of the devil instead of glorifying God. Afraid of the witches and wizards instead of afraid of God, the owner of heaven and earth. They remove the fear of God from the church, and they place the fear of people and the witches and wizards in the church. We must repent. We must glorify God.
Amen.
We must reduce the ways we glorify human beings and the power of darkness, but glorify the power of God and the dominion of God over all the universe. Now, I'm mentioning all this ministry because those are the ones you know. There are many ones. These are the good ones. That's why I mentioned them. They are the good ones that came from God. But there are many ones that don't even come from God at all. God does not know their leaders. There are plenty. Many ministries that God does not send their leader. He doesn't even send them to come from. These are the ones that God sent. I'm talking to you about. That's why I love them and I want them to change to God. But the ones I don't mention their name, I cannot mention every ministry. But there are many people, many of them that God does not even know. And they will be saying, the Lord told me, son. There are many of them God cannot call son. But when they are talking on TV, they will say, God says, son, come and go there. God can never call some of them son. They are not son. Even Jeremiah, you see the way God called him. God said, son of man. That's the way he called him. That's the way God calls Jeremiah. Most of those old prophets, God will call them son of man. Daniel, son of man. He doesn't say my son. And some of them will now open their tie like somebody that just break up from I don't know what to mention where. And they will not stay on TV say, the Lord call me son. What son? Son from where? If you can call Daniel son of man, and they call Jeremiah son of man, you are the son. You that you are more hypocritical and more worldly and rebellious. Is that one they will call son? Please, we must change the way we look at God. And it must start from us here, individually. Myself, yourself. You must know the kind of people God calls son. Not everybody. You are a son of man until you become his son. His sons are those people that can no longer sin. That's why the one God calls son. Not you that are committing sin every day. The Bible tells us that the sons of God cannot sin because they have what? God in them. Therefore, they cannot sin. Until that happens to you, you are a son of man. The next one, the love of the world is foundational adultery of the church. The love of the world has become foundational adultery of the church. Do you understand what I mean? When you love the world, the beginning of the love of the world has become foundation of majority of the church on earth. Let's read complete that James chapter 4, 1 to 6 now. James chapter 4, verses 1 to 6. I read quickly from here. James 4, 1 to 6, for the sake of time. Where do wars and fights come from among you? Do they not come from your desires for pleasure? That war in your members, you lust and do not have. You murder and covet and cannot obtain. You fight and war. Yet you do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask amiss, that you may spend it on your pleasures. Adulterer and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself or herself an enemy of God. Or do you think that the scripture says in vain, the spirit who dwells in you yearns jealousy, but he gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. So you must know, the Bible says, where does the fight among you Christians come from? The fight in the church. Grumble in the church. Over the pulpit, pastors are fighting pastors. Believers are fighting believers. People are praying against themselves in the church. They believe their enemy is sitting next to them in the church. People cannot trust anybody in the church anymore with their secrets and their thoughts. Where does those things come from? That's what the book of James is saying. He said it comes from what? Friendship with the world. The church has become like world. We are not different with the world. Our dressing with the world is the same. Our talk with the world is the same. You see, the kind of slang and slogans in the church, in the world, is what the church also is speaking. You see Christians speaking slang like the world. You will see the song. The song of the church is like a song of the world now, isn't it? Uruko Jesu, making me the scatter. Uruko Jesu, now they make me slay. In the church of God. And the song of Church of God away. What are we becoming? What is the meaning of that? We must break the image of worldliness from the pulpit of the church. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
We must break and pull down that cast image of worldliness from every pulpit of the church.
Amen.
As if that one is not even enough, they brought another one now. People make comedy in the church. They bring the worldly comedy. Because the church of God pray, it doesn't work anymore. They preach to them, God, they bring joy. They are not happy. They now bring people to make them happy with sugar. They now go back and say, yeah, church of God, hallelujah. You know what happened to happen yesterday? And I was going somewhere yesterday. One pastor saw me. They said, hey, in the church. My people, where are we going? What is happening? Can't Jesus make us happy anymore? Are we lost our happiness in Christ? Is the joy of salvation no longer there? Why do we need comedian to make us laugh in the church? Why? The church needs to pull down the image of what? Worldliness from the occupant of the church.
Amen.
We have built a calf image. Our Aaron of our time has built up the calf image. Because we have contributed our jewelries to make it happen. Because those Aaron of the church now, they know that that's what you want. So they give you what you want against their wish. Most of these pastors, they know the truth, I'm telling you. They know the truth. Oh, they know the truth. Majority of pastors know what is right. Some of them, when they finish preaching, they go to their office and begin to think, say, God, have I delivered the right thing? Or I've just done these people what they like. Some of them have conscience. They are troubled with what they teach you. They are troubled with the way they lead you. But they don't just want to give in because the devil is pushing them to say, go on. You're not making any mistake. And they begin to continue to mislead. Because the image has already been built in the church. Unless the image is pulled down by prayer, destroyed by thunder of the Holy Ghost, out of all the churches, that is when the pastors' eyes will be open. And when are we going to start doing that?
Now!
We are going to be start doing that. Who is God going to use to do that?
Me!
God's going to use to do that. You have to go to all churches. You have to preach the gospel. You have to speak the truth, even though they will not allow you to come back here again after your first topic. Don't go, you go to the next one. Because God must bring down the image of worldliness that the Aaron of our time has built on all the altar of the churches. They must come down for the church to see the truth. They must come down for what?
The church to see the truth.
Now we go to the last part, Bible part today. It says, the repentance of God's people. Now after we have known the truth that the church has gone wrong, what do we need to do? Repentance. Let us read this. I will see how the church of God can repent. Jeremiah 3, 6 to 15. Jeremiah 3, 6 to 15. Jeremiah chapter 3. Jeremiah 3, chapter 6. Chapter 3, verses 6 to 15. I read here. The Lord said also to me in the days of Josiah, the king, have you seen what backsliding Israel has done? She has gone up on every high mountains and under every green tree, and there played the harlot. And I said, after he had gone all these things, return to me. But she did not. She did not return. And her treasurer's sister, Judah, saw it. Then I said, I saw that for all the the causes for which backsliding Israel had committed adultery, I had put her away and given her a certificate of divorce. Yet her treasurer sister Judah did not fear, but went and played the harlot also. So it came to pass through her casual harlotry that she defiled the land and committed adultery. She defiled the land and committed adultery with stones and trees. And yet, for all this, our treasurer's sister Judah had not turned to me with her whole heart, but in pretense, says the Lord. In pretense, says the Lord. 11. Then the Lord said to me, backsliding Israel has shown herself more righteous than treacherous Judah. Go and proclaim these words towards the north and say, return, backsliding Israel, says the Lord. I will not cause my anger to fall on you, for I am merciful, says the Lord. I will not remain angry forever. Only acknowledge your iniquity, that you have transgressed against the Lord your God, and have scattered your charms to alien deities under every green trees, and you have not obeyed my voice, says the Lord. Return, O backsliding children, says the Lord, for I am married to you. I will take you one from a city and two from family, and I will bring you to Zion, and I will give you the shepherd according to my heart, who will feed you with knowledge and understanding. The Lord wants us to do what? He wants every backsliding choice to repent today. Every backsliding Aaron to return today in humility. Be humble and listen to your Moses today. Repent from all your ways. Repair the standard of a church, the setup of a church. Every structure of the church that is being built for selfish reasons must be brought down. Every altar, every calf that is on the altar, the calf of worldliness, they must be pulled down.
Amen.
The calf of friendliness with the world, they must be pulled down.
Amen.
And let everything be done decently and orderly. Decently and orderly in the church of God. And let all our heart turn unto God. God is promising us today, this is the last chance, that He is a merciful God. He's not angry. He's not going to be angry forever. He wants His church to repent. Every backsliding church and ministers, we must repent and turn to God today. Because the Lord is stretching His hand and He wants to save us today.
Amen.
If we will come to Him.
Amen.
Your heart might be deviated from God. Your body might be in the church today. And your heart might not be in the church. Some of you are here, you only dress for us the way we like when you come here. And when you go back to the world, you dress the way you like when you go out. Some of us we are two faces. Amen? You know, I am someone that used to check faces of my members on their WhatsApp or their Facebook. I used to check their faces. I don't always go on Facebook. When I go there, I check the pictures of my members across the world, not only in Europe here. Every country, whether they are in Pakistan, whether they are in India, whether they are in Nigeria, whether they are in America, whether they are in the island of Manchester, I check the faces. And I see some, not all, a few people, they look like double face. Because when I see them, I see the way they look. But when I see those pictures, they look very different. You know, that's one I saw recently. I said, can this be our sister or this the woman? I look close, I said, can this be this woman's sister? I said, no, she's the one, she's not our sister. Because our sister will not put the picture on her. It can happen, you can put your picture, your brother's picture. But what I'm saying is that the image of worldliness and friendship with the world must do what? Must be put down from the altar of our mind and the church. And where does it start from? It starts from me. Say that.
It starts from me.
It starts from me.
It starts from me.
It starts from me. Stand up with that anger. And as you are going today, every worldliness in you, everything that loves the world in you, you want to do your ear tie like the world. You see somebody, you know, we copy people that are not Christian. You see somebody that is not a believer, you do one ear tie. You Christian, you say you want to do the same thing. Somebody wear one thing. Do you know the reason why they do all those fashion parade? Is to initiate this marine style to the world. Most of those ladies that do, they are not ordinary ladies. You know, And the originator of those fashion, if you see those women that used to be at the background of all those fashion issues, that sponsor, that if you want sponsorship, you go to them, they are the one that will sponsor it. They show one of them on the, my wife was showing me on the YouTube one day, the ear on her head was very long like snake like that. And they don't have any job, but they have money. And they can sponsor all the show and every fashion and everything. Why? Because they got their back. Their finances from the waters. Their money is from the marine kingdom. I told her some time ago that I said I saw powers of the marine kingdom. They were telling me that we'll make sure that you will not have money to do this ministry. There's nobody will. And what did they ask me to do? They gave me an offer and I rejected. They said, you have to preach for us. I said, what do you mean? You have to work for us? I said, what do you mean work for you? He said, you will not preach what you are preaching again. We'll give you your messages. And when you do that, we'll make you big. Everybody will know you in the world. You have miracles. You have money. But if you preach this thing you are preaching now, we'll deal with you. I said, you cannot do anything to me. They said, okay, you will see. I said, I will not work for you. I will not preach for you. I am preaching for he that has called me. That is the Lord, the living God, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. He is the messenger that will preach, not your message. They say, okay, we'll see. We'll take money from you. We'll take everything for you. Make sure you struggle with this thing you call ministry. Then we were fighting. That they were from waters. One woman was in the midst and young ladies, they surrounded her. And they were speaking like that to me. You see, and it was two times like that. Another group again, they was on land. They were not from water. Seven group. They also came. They said, we want to bargain with you, to work with you. I said, you cannot work with me because God, the people that are working with me, they are great. They are angels. They are powers from the living God. I don't need power from the heart to work with me. I don't need witches and wizards to work with me for miracle or for money. Because when I decided to be born again, I have given up everything I wanted to be. So I'm not interested in money or fame or anything. All I want is just to eat and my children to go to school. That's my passion for now. You see, fame, money, everything is not, I'm not interested. I just want to be able to preach the gospel in the corner of the place where I am and to reach everywhere God gives me permission to go. And if the Lord wants to be beyond that, he will make provision for it. Amen. The Lord is able. So now you are going to raise up your two hands. Say, oh Lord, my Father.
Oh Lord, my Father.
Let revival begin.
Let revival begin.
And let it start with me.
And let it start with me.
In the name of Jesus, begin to pray. Let the revival of the church begin. Let it start from me, Lord. Let your revival start from me. From my ways, from my sins, from my life, from my tongue, from my imagination. Let your revival start from me. In the name of Jesus. Let your revival start from my church, my life, my children, and wife, and myself. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, let your revival begin in me. Let your revival begin in me. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
You say, oh Lord, my Father.
Oh Lord, my Father.
Pull down today by fire.
Pull down today by fire.
Every calf image.
Every calf image.
Of worldliness.
Of worldliness.
Immorality.
Immorality.
And friendship with the world.
Friendship with the
in
world.
In my heart.
In my heart.
In my church.
In my church.
Destroy them today by fire. Begin to pray. Every cast image of worldliness, of arrogance, of friendship with the world, or immorality, built in my heart, put them by my fire. Pray, 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 pray.
What is
fire?
Amen.
I want you to say amen with fire. Amen with fire.
Amen.
Father, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I want to hear powerful amen from the beginning of my prayer to the end. I want you to say amen that will make you lose your voice by the time I finish. Oh Lord, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I pray for these people under my voice today. Every cast image. Every demonic image of worldliness, immorality, self-ambition, and worldliness that is built in your heart. in your life and the altar of your churches. I command the Holy Ghost power to knock them down to powder today. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Every satanic foundation, demonic foundation of your father and mother's house, harassing and terrorizing your salvation and your spiritual growth and development, I call the fire of God to destroy them today. Melt them to powder. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth.
Amen.
Oh Lord, my Father, these ones under my voice today, pull their life out of miry clay of infirmity, of destruction, of worldliness, of friendship with the world. Pull them out and place their feet upon the rock of salvation, Jesus of Nazareth. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth.
Amen.
Have mercy upon our soul. Let the revival begin in all churches. Let it start from us today. From our sin, from immorality, from every immorality and evil thought and speech and comportment, we want the revival to start from our lives today, Lord. Let your revival begin and let it come upon us, the Holy Ghost fire, to begin to redeem us, transform us, and make us into your image from today. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, Lord.
Amen.
Holy Ghost fire come upon us today. Holy Ghost fire come upon us today.
Amen.
The word of God says, you will receive power
yes.
when the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Lord, we want your power to manifest upon us. We want your Holy Ghost to fall upon us mightily to do this work. And this was testified and was visible in the life of the disciples when they received the Holy Ghost in chapter 2 of the book of Acts. The Bible says, and there was a tongue like fire that descended upon every one of them their head. And after that happened, they spoke with new tongues as evidence. And after that, then they got power. And power to witness Christ was first of all, and the rest miracle began to happen. Lord, I declare today, let your fire fall. Let your anointing fall.
Amen.
Let your Holy Ghost fall.
Amen.
Upon us, oh Lord,
Amen.
To be able to witness you across the nation of the world.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus of Nazareth.
Amen.
Lord, I give you glory. Lord, I give you praise. Lord, I give you honor. I commit our ways before you this week. Let your presence go before us, Lord. Let your presence surround us, Father.